Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming to tonight's event. This is a Ross Parsons Center for Corporate Commercial and Taxation Law seminar. We are also recording this and we'll post it up on the law school's website and on our YouTube page. And the goal of these seminars run over many years by Professor Hill and then in more recent years by myself as the director of the Ross Parsons Center, is really to engage with the profession and the business community with some of the research that's being done in the law school and also amongst other corporate and commercial and taxation scholars around Australia. The topic that we'll be discussing tonight is non-consensual third-party releases in insolvency, lessons from the Purdue Pharma case in the US Supreme Court. This is an issue that's been bubbling up in many jurisdictions over the years. It's something that I've done some work on in years past, particularly one of the cases that I'll talk about tonight, the High Court's decision in the Lehman Brothers case. And it's an issue that's been very topical in many common law jurisdictions and also in the EU. It had been very controversial in the US for many years, with different circuits taking very different views. And then earlier this year, we've had the US Supreme Court finally confirming the issue. The structure of the presentation tonight is my colleague, Adjunct Professor, Associate Professor Lindsay Powers, who teaches with us here in the law school in our postgraduate insolvency program and has done for many years. Lindsay's also an active member of the Ross Parsons Center, participates in many events, and he's also a senior legal consultant at Minter Ellison. My research is largely on corporate debt restructuring and voluntary administration, so I'll be talking about third-party releases in deeds of company arrangement and schemes of arrangement in Australia. The presentation will likely go for about 40 minutes or so, and then we're certainly happy to take questions and comments at the end of that. I would also just note that we do have some refreshments at the back of the room if you'd like to have that at the end of the presentation. But if you do have any questions, we're certainly happy to answer those questions at the end of the presentation. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Lindsay.
Thanks, Jason.
A good start. Don't seem to be we on.
Maybe it's out of batteries. Otherwise, you can just click the down arrow.
Yep. Frozen, Jason. It was working.
There we go. And then just click down arrow.
Okay.
So I think it's important to do a little bit of scene setting for tonight's presentation to understand some of the fundamental concepts that give us some insights into what's been going on in the US and in Australia. So to quickly talk about releases of claims in insolvency, it's important to bear in mind that in most contexts in insolvency, the idea of a company becoming insolvent and then entering into some form of insolvency administration is with a view to resolving the claims that are against the company itself. So there is a focus on claims against the debtor. And in Australia, of course, if the claim against a debtor is what's called provable. That's to say it qualifies to participate in the relevant insolvency administration. Then generally, that will also mean that there is a stay on any individual rights to take action against the company. It's a collective process where the debtor's assets are going to be made available to the claims that have been established and are admissible in the proceedings. Now, when we talk then about looking at rights against third parties, not claims against the debtor, but claims against third parties, and there are many circumstances in which there may be a liability, joint and several, by somebody else. And what it means is that in general terms, once again, because the focus of the insolvency process is resolving claims against the debtor, those who are entitled to bring the claim should be entitled to pursue those claims against those third parties and only have an effect by way of a resolution or discharge of that claim with the consent of that claimant. Whereas against the debtor, the object is to resolve the claims and they take effect as a matter of law. That is to say, the claim is resolved, you are entitled to participate. Not so with claims against third parties. The third party should be able to decide whether or not it's going to release the claim. So what we are talking about tonight is the status of non-consensual releases of claims against third parties, where a process purports to have the effect of not only resolving a claim against the debtor, but resolving claims against third parties. And this is the issue that came before the Supreme Court of the United States in the Purdue Pharma bankruptcy. Now, the Purdue Pharma organization has become synonymous with a massive public health crisis brought about in particular by the distribution of a manufactured drug called OxyContin. And the Purdue Pharma corporate entities have been controlled for a very long time by members of the Sackler family. Just to give you some idea about the Sacklers, let me just show you this.
We can.
Richard Sackler.
Hello.
You did a good job making all that money, sir.
Thank you.
You ever prosecute a company as big as Purdue Pharma?
All of human behavior is essentially comprised of two things. Run from pain, run toward pleasure. Pain, pleasure, pain, pleasure. If we place ourselves right there between pain and pleasure, we will never have to worry about money again.
Pain is no longer something we have to tolerate. We have an answer.
How can something legally prescribed be killing so many people?
Tell me what words you associate with oxycodone.
Oxy what?
Oxycoffins.
Excuse me?
Don't put that in the notes.
We are under investigation.
That's a short extract from the Netflix series Painkiller, and if you haven't seen it, I do recommend you have a look at it. It's very entertaining and in some cases horrifying to see how this all unfolded. So I think Jason's given a general outline of how we're going to proceed tonight. I'm going to talk to you about how Purdue Pharma ended up in its bankruptcy. I'm going to talk about the decision in the Supreme Court of the United States. And then Jason will move to the position of third-party releases in relation to deeds of company arrangement and schemes. And I'll come back and just have a quick word about possible implications of the Supreme Court decision on the position in Australia. Now, the background is that the drug that was marketed, OxyContin, was considered to be entirely unsafe and yet was marketed as a safe pain-killing medication. It resulted ultimately, after a long series of intrigues in litigation, class actions, many, many, many class actions being brought, many claims being made, not only by individual patients who'd been prescribed the drug, but also by various states in the United States and local communities who had suffered the consequences of all of this in terms of the medical expenditure that had to be dedicated towards treating this opioid crisis. The result was litigation just became an absolute bushfire. And in the face of the claims, they vastly exceeded the value of Purdue Pharma's assets. And so they filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy in the United States. It's sometimes referred to as Chapter 11 protection, and I'll explain why that is so in a moment. There, in these contexts, a debtor coming to face these claims offers to its creditors an arrangement whereby they are given a guaranteed outcome of a particular monetary amount. And what happened in this case was that Purdue Pharma proposed a plan whereby creditors would receive up to $6 billion over a 10-year period in order to secure the approval of the Chapter 11 plan. It's worth noting that as for the Purdue Pharma companies themselves, the idea was that they were to continue in existence, and they do continue in existence. They're trading today. However, the objective of the plan was to turn these companies into social remediation organizations, so that any profits they generated from the sales of their other pharmaceuticals would be all dedicated towards a charitable purpose. But the main interest for the Sacklers was that in return for this contribution of a cash amount, they were going to be released. Now, it's also important to just note that this $6 billion amount that they were going to contribute back over 10 years was in the face of them having extracted out of the Purdue Pharmas, pharma companies, over a period of some years prior to the filing for bankruptcy, of an amount estimated to be $11 billion, referred to in submissions as the milking of Purdue Pharma by the Sackler family. So they're prepared to put back six of the $11 billion that they've managed to transfer overseas.
Quick point on that.
Yeah.
I found really interesting in the case was they talk about the history of the dividend payments in the Purdue Pharma to the Sacklers, and they kind of tracked through different years, and they were taking out this amount, this amount, this amount. Then they were investigated by federal authorities, and they entered into an agreement with the federal authorities on one aspect. And then from then, they've dramatically increased the dividend payments that they were taking out of the company. So that by the time we get towards the bankruptcy filing, they have, in essence, milked most of the assets out of the company.
And it was often referred to in the argument before the Supreme Court that what had been done had been a very sophisticated way of moving assets out of the jurisdiction into places where there was at least a significant obstacle in attaching to those assets now that they're out of the United States, and hence they're offering voluntarily to bring the money back. But the condition was not only that there be a resolution of the claims against the Purdue Pharma companies, but against the Sacklers individually. The plan was approved ultimately by the Second Circuit Court of Appeals after a number of earlier phases of hearing and appeal. And then ultimately the Supreme Court granted permission to appeal so that this whole issue of the third party non-consensual releases could be determined. That is to say, is it appropriate to have or is it lawful to have such releases in a Chapter 11 plan? So that's the docket number. The official US report page number hasn't yet come out, but that's the current way of citing it, I am told. There they are, the learned justices, current learned justices of the Supreme Court of the United States. The procedural history was that they granted certiorari, is what they call it there, but in Australia we would call that leave to appeal, so that the Supreme Court takes on the case in August 2003. The case came on for argument on the 4th of December, 2023, and judgment was delivered 27 June, 2024, which some commentators have said is a very unusual outcome in terms of the time that was taken to get to judgment. They're usually much quicker. So that did suggest when it was not being announced that the judgment was coming anytime soon, there was a suggestion, therefore, that there was some considerable debate going on amongst the judges after they had reserved and considered the judgment. And I've read the transcript of the argument before the court, and the to and fro back and forth from counsel and the Supreme Court judges indicated that there was really no consensus that you could really pick out. A lot of judges that you wouldn't be expecting to offer particular viewpoints were offering those viewpoints, and others vice versa. So it's worthwhile just quoting this, because this is what the Sacklers said they wanted in return for bringing the money back. This is what they wanted the plan to endorse. A release, and this is these are in the words of the petitioner, that when they describe the release that was being sought, it extends to claims based on fraud and other willful misconduct that could not have been discharged even if the Sacklers themselves had submitted to bankruptcy and thereby surrendered all of their assets. The plan instead permits the Sacklers, who otherwise face claims alleging damages in the trillions, to obtain full repose while keeping billions of dollars that they siphoned from Purdue in the years before these Chapter 11 proceedings. So it was obviously a release that they had thought about for a long while, and they did not want any loopholes. And so all of these causes of action were sucked up in the release. Now, a word for those of you who are not familiar with the Chapter 11 procedure. Very similar to an Australian scheme of arrangement under Part 5.1 of the Corporations Act. It involves a plan of reorganisation. It needs to specify who are the creditors who are going to be affected adversely by the plan. There needs to be a disclosure statement prepared. In Australia, we would call that an explanatory memorandum. It has to be approved by the court before it's sent to the creditors. And it's supposed to explain what the plan is going to do and the impact of it on creditor rights. Again, similar to Australia, creditors vote in classes, and you need an approval by majority in number and two-thirds in value of each of the classes. One distinction with a Chapter 11 plan from a scheme of arrangement is, in the United States, there is a process called cram down, where if you obtain approval from virtually all of the classes of creditors, but there's a holdout group, then against their wishes, the court, if it's satisfied that it's appropriate and just, the court is entitled to approve the plan, notwithstanding the failure to obtain approval of that class. That's not the case in Australia. After the voting on the plan, it goes back to the court again for confirmation, very similar to Australia. But here's something that distinguishes the US position quite significantly from the Australian position, and that is that the US legislation says what should go into a plan that's being sought, to be approved under Chapter 11. Two different sections apply. There's one section, 1123A, which talks about mandatory provisions. So all plans that are submitted for approval under Chapter 11 have to contain these particular provisions, and they're not surprising, specify which claims are affected, how the plan's going to be implemented, etc. Importantly, for our purposes tonight, there is another section, 1123B, which provides for discretionary provisions. So these things can be included if you want. There are six subsections, and they talk about things like means of settlement and adjustment of claims against the debtor, disposal of the debtor's property, and similar. Now, except for the case of asbestos liabilities, there is no express provision in the US Bankruptcy Code and the provisions that apply to a plan of reorganization under Chapter 11, which enables the release of claims against third parties. You can do it as a result of an amendment to the Bankruptcy Code. You can do it in the case of mass tort liabilities for asbestos liability, but not for anything else. And in fact, Section 524E says that a discharge, which is obtained through a bankruptcy under Chapter 11, does not affect, it expressly says it doesn't affect the liability of other persons. How the case was argued was that there is authorization in a catch-all provision, in those discretionary provisions that I've referred to. In Section 1123B6, it says that in addition to all of these things that can be included, it is possible to have any other appropriate provision not inconsistent with the applicable provisions of this title. And that's how the Purdue plan came to court, and that is the provision where the respondents argued they were entitled to include in a plan a release in favour of the Sacklers. Now, the petitioner in this case was a person called the US Bankruptcy Trustee. This is a government-appointed official from the Department of Justice administers this area. And the US Bankruptcy Trustee basically has a supervisory role to ensure the proper functioning of this particular area of law. And so that's how this got to the Supreme Court. It was approved, the plan was approved by the Second Circuit Court of Appeals, and the US Bankruptcy Trustee came in and said, no, we don't think this plan should be approved. We do not think that the Sacklers should be released. We would like the Supreme Court to determine it. Now, the arguments were these. In the first place, 1123b6, that catch-all provision, does not give this vast power to release something which is so unconnected with the estate of the debtor as to give it a status that it does not deserve. All of the preceding subclauses in those discretionary provisions, they all concern claims with respect to the estate of the debtor. They say nothing about claims against third parties. And what's more, they said the existence of this express provision that allows release of third-party claims in the case of asbestos liabilities alone indicates that the use of the power is impermissible. And they also said, when you look at that provision that talks about any other provision, so long as it's not inconsistent with this code, well, there are inconsistencies with the overall code. Discharge of obligations occurred before bankruptcy is only available to the debtor. And what the Sacklers were basically doing was getting the functional equivalent, is how it was described, the functional equivalent of a discharge of claims without doing what you usually have to do, and that is to put all of your assets on the table. They weren't going anywhere near that. So there was conflict with other provisions of the code. So 1123b6 does not apply. And also, on a matter of public policy, this really shouldn't be allowed, because what it does is it enables tortfeasors to obtain immunity without subjecting themselves to the whole scrutiny of a bankruptcy that would apply to them individually if they can tack this release onto the bankruptcy of a corporate entity. Just in relation to the point about the provisions of section 1123b6, the catch-all provision, it was interesting. Chief Justice Roberts, in the course of argument, took exception, it would seem, to the argument that the catch-all provision could apply, using a rather colourful expression that you wouldn't expect to find an elephant in a mouse hole. And having seen that, my view was, well, when the judgment comes down, I know which way Chief Justice Roberts is going to go. Well, as we will see, my view was incorrect. The respondent, that's to say the Sackler bankruptcy proponents, were arguing that section 1123b6 means exactly what it says. Anything that is appropriate, and in these circumstances, when the Sacklers are saying you can have the $6 billion back if we get a release, then that is going to produce an outcome that is appropriate, and we think that therefore we can argue that that subsection applies. They said there are no conflicting provisions with the code, because what the Sacklers are obtaining here is not a discharge, they're obtaining a release in the terms that are set out in the plan, not a discharge. I don't know that that argument really stands up to a lot of scrutiny, but that's the way it was put. And in relation to the argument that Congress allowed third-party releases in the case of asbestos, but in no other circumstance, they said, well, Congress didn't hint, let alone say, don't do this anywhere else. They also argued that the US Bankruptcy Trustee didn't have standing to be appealing this decision, but the judges in argument didn't seem to be very interested in that particular submission. So what did they decide? A 5-4 split. 5-4 holding that you cannot have a non-consensual release against claims for claims against third parties in the Chapter 11. The way the split was, the majority, Justice Gorsuch, a conservative justice, wrote the opinion for the majority, joined by Justice Thomas, Justice Alito, Justice Barrett, and surprisingly, the most recent Democrat appointee to the Supreme Court, Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson. She joined the majority. She was the casting vote on this. The minority decision, written by Justice Kavanaugh, if you read the decision, he gets extremely emotional, very, very forceful in saying this is a practical outcome that should be allowed. Let's not have all of this sophistry. Let's just let the practical outcome be permitted to stand, get the money to these claimants, and we can move on. Joined with Justice Roberts and Justices Sotomayor and Kagan, again, Democrat-leaning judges joining in the dissent. Why did they decide that way? Well, the first thing was they said 1123B says what you can have. The first five sub-clauses in those discretionary provisions are all about the debtor's relationship with its own creditors, not with respect to third parties, and therefore, by reference to that, you construe the catch-all provision as being limited to the debtor, not third parties. The principle of construction, which we have recognised in Australia from time to time, e justum generis. The foregoing is to be construed as controlling what comes after. And they also said to reinforce that the scheme of the code is to give a discharge to someone who puts all of their assets on the table. And the Sacklers were getting a release without doing this. Importantly, in just the last paragraph of the judgment, and I think this is one of the most important paragraphs in the majority decision, they say what this decision is not to be held to be determining. They said, we are not determining that a consensual release under a plan is unlawful. We do not need to decide that. That is not what we're dealing with here. So in other words, if, for example, you had a Chapter 11 plan where there was an opt-in or an opt-out provision, that is to say, if you want to participate in this amount of money, then by all means, but you have to elect to be bound by it. But if you don't want to, you don't have to. So ultimately, it ends up being a consensual release. They said, we're not making any determinations about that, nor were they making any determination about what is the outcome of this case now that we have decided that you can't have these releases, when in fact they have been included in prior Chapter 11 plans for other debtors. The Boy Scouts Association of America successfully propounded a Chapter 11 plan which contained third-party releases, and they were an active participant in these proceedings. They filed an amicus brief. The court is saying we don't have to decide what we have before us today, its impact on that which has completely been effectuated. In other words, the argument may well be it's too late for those plans to be attacked. So that's what happened in Purdue Pharma in the US Supreme Court. And Jason's going to give us a tour of what's the position in Australia.
Thanks, Lindsay. Yeah, it was a much anticipated case, that Supreme Court case. The US has an interesting system with their circuit courts, and even though bankruptcy is national legislation, they do end up with highly inconsistent provisions, rulings in between the various circuits. And so that's actually one of the grounds that the Supreme Court relies upon to take a case, is where there is a clear circuit split, which there was on third-party releases. So to turn to the Australian position, this is something that we've looked at in a few cases. We had our own apex court look at this in the Lehman Brothers case back in 2010, and this was something that I followed fairly closely. We would draw a distinction between deeds of company arrangement which come from a period of voluntary administration. In contrast to voting on Chapter 11 plans in the US, you don't need to put creditors into different classes in voluntary administration. You just need a simple majority in number and value in order to get a deed of company arrangement approved. Although generally secured creditors, for example, wouldn't necessarily participate because that way they don't need to be bound by the outcome. So they maintain some degree of control. The Lehman Brothers dispute concerned a very small part of the global Lehman Brothers empire. So Lehman Brothers, that some of you in the room might recall, is a very large global investment bank. When it collapsed following the global financial crisis, the approach that the debtors' advisors took was to try and resolve the global Lehman bankruptcy basically by containing it to US and the rest of the world, mostly through the UK and Europe. And Australia was a tiny, tiny part of that. Lehman's had taken over a small Australian-based financial advisory firm, which had a fairly specialist practice that may well have involved some potential misleading conduct and other liabilities. But the idea was that, well, we don't want to be running, you know, 100 different bankruptcies throughout the world. We want to try and resolve it as much as we can. And so the plan that was put with respect to the Australian arm of the business, which was ultimately coming through its parent company in Hong Kong, was to, as they put it, try and tie a bow in the administration. And the idea was that they would put some money into the Australian deed of company arrangement, but there's no such thing as a free lunch. And so they then wanted releases for the directors, particularly relating to the directors and officers' insurance, and then also releases for the parent company and the parent company's directors. Now, that was subject to some pretty intense negotiation. By the time they actually got to court, they'd actually given up most of that, but they still had some third-party releases, and then that went all the way to the High Court as to whether you could do this in a deed of company arrangement. Now, for those that aren't insolvency specialists, I think it's useful to note that the voluntary administration and deed of company arrangement procedure in Australia has been pretty successful, and particularly on large insolvencies and restructurings. And one of the features of that regime is that it is very flexible. So we have these powers in Part 5.3A that allow the court to craft all sorts of orders to provide for the best commercial outcome in the circumstances. And so when this went up to the High Court, there was a hope that the High Court was going to maintain that flexibility because they, you know, we've looked at the Sackler example, which maybe is all the reasons not to have a third-party release in those circumstances, but there can be very good reasons to have a third-party release. You know, if we take a more standard commercial scenario where there's not the same degree of potential fraud, guarantors, for example, might want to support a restructuring, but in exchange for providing funding, they would like to avoid the subsequent potential liability. So there can be very good reasons to have third-party releases. So this came up to the High Court, and the High Court, to a certain extent, took a somewhat similar approach to the US Supreme Court many years later in saying, look, this all comes down to the wording of the legislation. And unfortunately, the provisions in Part 5.3A, as flexible as they are, they do make it clear that what rights can be affected by a deed of company arrangement are the rights that the creditor has against the debtor. And it doesn't say the rights that the creditor has against really anyone else. And so this was one of the few cases that we've had that's gone up to the High Court considering voluntary administration that has actually been fairly literal in terms of its construction of the Act. Contrast that, for example, with a subsequent decision in the Mighty River case, where the High Court was much more flexible in the operation of voluntary administration. So the relevant passages are there. Paragraph 53 is probably the main one there, but it is just making it clear that, you know, deeds of company arrangement can't cover everything. They cover claims that the creditors have against the debtor and not against third parties. So that then sets up an interesting series of cases that followed from the Lehman Brothers case. The Boral Bricks case was actually pretty shortly after that. There was a third-party release included, and the court then basically took further submissions after the High Court's decision was published and then said, no, you can't have a third-party release in a docker, and so we're going to set it aside on that basis. The most recent case, which some people in the room were actually part of, the Academy Construction case, also involved a third-party release. And the judge in that case, Justice Black in the Supreme Court here, had quite a detailed discussion about why that third-party release could not be severed from the deed of company arrangement. There's a very interesting thread of discussion in some of these cases about the fundamental nature of what deeds of company arrangement are. And to a certain extent, we might say, calling them a deed of company arrangement is almost a little bit misleading because it makes it seem like they're a contract. And yet the courts have said to us time and time again, including the High Court, that actually these aren't contracts. Now, they might look a bit like a contract, but they take effect because of statute. And so we shouldn't just interpret everything we know about contracts and interpreting contracts and put them on deeds of company arrangement. So in some of these more recent cases, given that the High Court has said you can't have a third-party release, the question then arises as to whether the deed should be set aside if it does include a third-party release, or should you be able to sever that release from the deed and then still have it take effect? And of course, you can sever, you know, invalid or uncertain terms in contracts, for example. So this has then come up in the Academy case and also in the Eastmark case. Very different results in those two cases. And in the Academy case, the court basically went through and said, well, look, this really comes down to the fundamental question of whether or not the third-party release is actually important to the bargain that's being struck here, even if it's not technically a contract. We shouldn't be able to sever the third-party release if that's in part the reason why this party is putting up some money into the deed fund. And that really explains the difference between the recent Academy case and the Eastmark case, where in Eastmark, essentially the court was saying, you know, the third-party release wasn't mentioned to the creditors in the report to creditors. It wasn't put out in the information at the creditors' meeting. It wasn't discussed at the creditors' meeting. And yet, nonetheless, there's a third-party release. So in those circumstances, we can exercise it because it's actually not essential to the bargain in this particular case. Now, it was interesting in Eastmark, they even had a severance clause. You know, if there's any term of this deed that's ineffective or whatever, the court should be able to exercise it. Interestingly, the court said that it wasn't going to rely on that. It was relevant, but it wasn't determinative. It was actually that the third-party release wasn't essential to the bargain here, and so they were able to exercise it, whereas in Academy Global, it was held to be pretty essential to the bargain. Now, I think that point about the connection between seeking to release the third-party rights and the restructuring deal that's been forged here, I think, is the critical point. And we really see that when we get to scheme cases. So in Australia, we've got different types of restructuring regimes. We've just been discussing voluntary administration and deeds of company arrangement. We've had schemes of arrangement since the 1860s, and they allow companies to engage in arrangement or a compromise with one or more classes of their creditors, and have been used, you know, for more than 100 years to implement debt restructurings, and in some cases to save businesses. So the Fowler and Lindholm case concerned the collapse of another financial advisory firm, Opus Prime, also a bit of a fallout from the GFC. And in that case, you had the financial advisory firm that was engaging in what it referred to as securities lending, but which actually wasn't securities lending if you looked at the underlying documents. So it was potentially misleading its customers. It collapsed into insolvency. The banks that were funding Opus Prime basically took control of the securities that it had access to by reason of these securities lending arrangements, and then liquidated them. During the GFC, many of these companies were small cap companies. And so, you know, the prices of those shares fluctuated a lot once the sell down started to happen. And literally thousands and thousands of clients all around the world lost a lot of money because of that. And so they said that they had claims against the company. It was hopelessly insolvent. But they also then said they had claims against the banks that were funding Opus Prime, which was ANZ Bank and Merrill Lynch. And so you've then got these banks that are being subject to hundreds of different actions all around the world, and they wanted to try and put a cap on that. So they proposed a scheme of arrangement. It wasn't trying to save the business. It wasn't a restructuring. It was effectively a liquidation distribution using a scheme of arrangement. We're going to put up some money, hundreds of millions of dollars, but what we don't want to do is have to pay that and then still end up getting sued in potentially thousands of lawsuits for years to come. So this then raises pretty much the same question. Can you include third-party releases in a creditor's scheme? Now, one big difference between a creditor's scheme and a deed of company arrangement is you don't need court approval for a deed of company arrangement. So the creditors vote on it, and as long as it's effective, it then takes effect. Now, if creditors want to challenge it, they can do that in court. But with a scheme, you have to go to court twice. You have to get the court's permission to propose the scheme, and then once the creditors vote on it by the requisite majority, you need to go back to the court and get the court to sanction it. So that's one really significant difference between the operation of deeds of company arrangement and schemes. So this then comes up in Fowler, which is basically running around the same time as the first and second instance in the Lehman Brothers litigation. And we see the opposite result. So here we see initially at first instance with Justice Finkelstein and then confirmed on appeal that really what the court's saying here is a scheme is all about a compromise or an arrangement. And the concept of arrangement in a scheme is very, very flexible. It involves some sort of give and take. You can't just confiscate creditor rights. So you have to be giving them something in return. So there is this kind of give and take. And as long as you've got that give and take, as long as there is a close connection, as long as there is an adequate nexus between the release or the indemnity on the one hand and the relationship between the creditor and the company and as creditor and debtor on the other hand, then there's no reason why we can't include a third-party release. So that's a full federal court saying that you can, whereas the High Court said for deeds of company arrangement, you can't. Now, this analysis in Fowler and Lindholm has been applied in several subsequent cases. It's pretty routinely cited. Yes, you can do this. You can't do it in every scheme, but as long as you can satisfy that nexus test, that there has to be some concrete connection with the release that's being proposed with the underlying restructuring proposal, then you can go for a third-party release. And even in some very recent cases. Now, it's interesting looking at schemes in other jurisdictions because we've inherited our creditors' schemes from England. And so pretty much in every common law country, they have a version of the creditors' scheme of arrangement. So this issue has come up in other countries. Courts in England, although they were a little bit initially reluctant to include third-party releases, now they routinely do, both in their schemes provision in Part 26A of the Companies Act and also under the new restructuring plan in Part 26A of the Companies Act. We've seen Singapore also allow third-party releases. We've seen Canada allow third-party releases in their version of the scheme. So it has been recognised in many other countries. I'll now hand back to Lindsay.
So is the position going to change in Australia as a result of what the Supreme Court of the United States has said? Well, these decisions of the Supreme Court of the United States are treated with respect. There are any number of cases which involve a citation of a US Supreme Court decision, and the High Court has said, yes, we understand the reasoning and the argument there, and it's to be treated with respect, but obviously not part of our judicial hierarchy and so not binding on our High Court. But most significantly, we've got a difference in legislation. We've got those provisions in 1123 in the US Bankruptcy Code, which say what can go in. And we have the more liberal approach in Australia to simply say, well, is there a nexus? Is there a give and take? Completely different legislative schemes. Now, the question may be, well, is there some policy that should now be reviewed by the High Court? Because Fowler and Lindholm is a decision of the full federal court. It is not a decision of our highest court. And in fact, in the City of Swan case, the Lehman Brothers case, the High Court did say in a passage, nothing that we say here should be taken as making a comment one way or the other about the suitability of schemes of arrangement or third-party releases. We're only talking about deeds of company arrangement and the legislation is clear, you can't have it. There was, to my knowledge, at least one application for special leave to appeal in relation to a scheme of arrangement that contained third-party releases, and a special leave was refused, but the judges said that the reason they were doing that, noting that there was no decision of the High Court on this issue for schemes, it said it was not going to grant special leave because it wasn't a suitable vehicle for the question to be explored. So somebody at some stage, it may be significantly important to them to have this tested. It may go to the High Court. It's not yet been decided. But I think you can hear from what Jason is saying is that the commercial approach here is, why shouldn't we be able to get a better outcome for creditors in a sense that they are getting something in return? It's not a confiscation of their claims. The ANZ is putting up hundreds of millions of dollars for a release, but it's $100 million that these creditors may never see, or at least it may be uncertain by them taking their chances absent a release. One thing I think is, however, very important for Australian lawyers to consider, and that is, now that we know that according to the Supreme Court of the United States, you cannot have there a Chapter 11 plan that contains non-consensual third-party releases, what about the status of similar arrangements from other parts of the world that are brought to the United States for recognition? We now have a well-established procedure for cross-border insolvency recognition. The United States has ratified the UNCITRAL model law. Their provisions are found in Chapter 15 of the US Bankruptcy Code, and they're very similar to those that appear elsewhere in the world. And as is the case with the model law, as implemented by many jurisdictions, including the United States, there is a reservation of the right of the court who is being asked to approve and recognize the foreign insolvency and the provisions that relate to it. There is a proviso that the court does not have to recognize the relevant scheme if it would be contrary to the public policy of that jurisdiction. Now, the question is, having now decided that it is unlawful to have in the United States an insolvency scheme which gives releases to third parties without consent, is that in fact contrary to the public policy of the United States? Does the fact that it is not permitted in the United States mean that it is not appropriate as a matter of public policy for the United States to do it? Just across the border in Canada, third-party releases are well and truly embedded in their similar procedures, and Canadian cross-border integration with the United States is something of considerable significance. And in Australia, I know of several cases that my firm has been involved in where we have had to take to the United States for recognition a scheme of arrangement approved in Australia. Boat Longyear was one of them. Now, that didn't involve third-party releases, but the importance is, if you are dealing with a transnational insolvency and you need to have some form of recognition of an Australian scheme of arrangement in the United States, you will have to grapple with this issue. That is to say, should the court refuse to recognize under the relevant provisions because it is not in accordance with the United States public policy.